Hi.
Hey.
Hi.
Hello. Hi. Can
Hi.
you hear me?
Yeah. Still you're audible. Hi, Ramesh.
Hi.
Hi, Gautam.
Hey, how are you?
I'm good.
Hey Ramesh, he said,
Hi.
how are you?
I'm good. Good to see all of you finally.
Yeah, great to see you guys. All cooped up in our own houses.
Yeah.
This dystopian world we're living in.
Totally dystopian. But I think we are getting used to it. Now I'll be bored with the normal world, I think.
I like to say that it's possibly the world's largest social experiment that we're going through right now.
I'm telling you.
Okay, so I'm muting everyone else. Give me a second. All of you all, Gautam, Ramesh, and Sid, please unmute yourself.
Yeah.
Yes,
Yeah. Done? All right. So, hi everyone. Thank you for joining. Yeah, so today's webinar is by HT Smartcast, and HT Smartcast is India's probably largest podcasting platform in the sense of the way that we are growing, the fastest growing. We have 100 plus podcasts. And we've got so many genres. We've crossed 5.5 million listens. And this webinar is called Podcast Storytelling and Shiz. So we'll speak about podcasts and we'll talk about storytelling and then we'll see what to talk about. So essentially, yeah, we'll just decide as we go along. And I have with me three amazing men. Let me first introduce them and then I'll have some of my questions and then last 10 minutes we'll take all your questions. Okay, let me start with Sid, the traveling professor. He's also doing a podcast by the name of The Traveling Professor's Diary. And he teaches various subjects like, I mean, I just love the way he introduces himself in the podcast. Marketing, what business, the business of media, business transformation, blah, 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 blah. So he teaches various subjects across various campuses like Mica, Flame, and various others. And I think he's one person, I would say that somebody can learn so much from him within the classroom and outside of it as well. And moving on to, so welcome, Sid, welcome. Thanks for
Yeah,
joining. Thanks. Moving on to Ramesh. Ramesh, can you put your camera on so that everybody can see you? Yeah. So Ramesh has a lot of industry exposure, experience around. With a lot of industries for around 30 years, including FMCG, telecom, manufacturing, retail. And now he's working in media. So he's heading the digital innovations vertical at HT Media. And within that digital innovations businesses falls HT Smartcast, which is our podcast business, and several other businesses like Hellshots, which is a website for dedicated curated content for millennial women, and some other audio businesses. So, personally, I think he's one person who's an absolute go-getter. Like, no matter how many constraints are there, and no matter how much challenging those constraints are, so he's one person who actually gets things done. So, one of the nicest and sweetest people that I've met in my life. So, welcome, Ramesh. Thank you for joining in. So, moving on to Gautam. Yeah, so Gautam is the CEO of Hubhopper, which has so much of audio content across genres in around 15 vernacular languages, which in itself is a great thing. Apart from that, Hubhopper works a lot from the creator perspective as well, with Hubhopper Studio and various other platforms. It has an app, website, so many other things. So Gautam, I don't know him so much, but then what I've heard about him is that he's very passionate about storytelling, about podcasts. And I read your LinkedIn profile and it says you hear to audio content 14 hours a day. Oh my God, that's like huge. So welcome, Gautam. Thanks for joining in.
Thank you so much. Yes, yes, I do. My wife thinks I'm a complete kook.
All right. So let's begin. So let's start with stories in general. And I think I'd like to start this with Gautam, because you're very passionate for storytelling. So what is your fondest memory of stories? And what is in it in storytelling that you like the most? Go on. All yours.
Okay, so I mean, I think before I jump in, I mean, see how much the world has changed that I realized that I actually went and got a haircut for a Zoom meetup. This is a new and a first for me. I think my love for stories and storytelling is very, very deep rooted because I think as a child, I grew up in a joint family. So a very sort of loud Punjabi joint family. And two huge influences for me in my house at the time were one was my grandmother, who has the most extraordinary life possible. And I mean, for me, I had a very strange sort of equation, because I would come back from school and essentially my grandmother would be sitting in the lawn having a beer along with like Kheera, and she'd tell all of us stories, and her stories range from how she met my grandfather to how they fell in love to the movie she's acted in or the radio shows that she's been a part of herself, a very emphatic speaker herself. So I mean, it was a pleasure growing up in that atmosphere. And then to compound that, my aunt is actually a writer. Her name's Paro Anand, and she's a sort of big writer in the children's literature domain. So with all of us kids in the house, we would essentially be the guinea pigs for her stories and for her books. So on the breakfast table or on the lunch table, we would essentially have her sort of performing stories in very dramatized fashion. And I think I just grew up in that sort of environment. I didn't really do it consciously. I was very, very lucky. So, I mean, I've gravitated towards audio and storytelling as a byproduct of that. But yeah, I think that's where my first love and interaction came with it. A little later on in my life, I think I fell in love with storytelling in the form of podcasts as a sort of means to an end. I was working in a very different trajectory. I was working at Barclays as a risk analyst. It was possibly the most boring job on the planet. So what I would essentially do to make my day slightly more fun and intriguing and interesting is I would listen to a lot of podcasts. So I would actively listen to them when I could. I would passively tune out to them when I could. And I just found it to be one of the most sort of considerate mediums. It didn't take away time from my day, but rather gave me time back. So that was my sort of falling in love with the medium.
All right. Very interesting. So, Sid, do you want to go next? What is your story about stories?
Well, I think this is today is all about grandmoms, because my grandmom used to tell me stories and my brother stories. So, forgive me for sounding like a stuck record, but this is a really funny one. We used to sleep, and my grandmother, unfortunately, she was the headmistress of a school, so really high, achievement oriented sort of person. And I guess teaching runs in the family. So I was, she used to start sleeping much before her story completed. And we were like waiting eagerly for what happened to Ram when he entered Lanka, and Ram continuously stayed in Lanka because my grandmother was asleep. So we used to wake her up. Poor lady used to get up, tell the story again. It was really a fun sort of situation to be in. And if I have to now look back upon it, I really feel sorry for her. But besides that, I feel that stories for me represent safety, because, you just that comfort feeling. And I think that feeling of safety is what I get when I listen to a podcast. I started listening to a variety of podcasts, especially since I started traveling as a professor. So if I'm going, my family's out there in London, I live in Pune, travel to Ahmedabad, Mumbai, etc., blah, blah. So the fact is that every time I'm going to a new place, the only consistent thing is the way in which I go to sleep. So the way in which I go to sleep is, I put a podcast on, and that humming thing, it just makes me feel very nice. And I think it's an honor for any podcaster who actually says that, I put my audience to sleep, because that is probably the ultimate high ground for a podcaster. I hope that I reach to that stage at some stage in my life. So those are the stories. This is my transition.
Yeah. So half of it you listen consciously, and then half of it just goes in your subconscious mind.
Most of the time, I've actually kind of timed it. So it's about 12, 13 minutes in, and I start my prefrontal cortex kind of shuts down, and now slowly but sometimes it's still going on. When I wake up again, I shut it. So but that's a really good way, because you feel safe.
Nice. Yeah, this is the first time that I'm listening to someone saying audio gives me safety. That's why I think it always comes up with new perspectives. So that's amazing. Yeah. Okay, Ramesh, over to you.
Oh, I'm not a storyteller. The person who inspired me is awesome. And once he starts telling a story, he doesn't stop. And that's really, captivating in a sense. And that's my experience with storytelling has been listening to entrepreneurs like him give us their pitch, right? I mean, last few years of my life, I've been working with a lot of startups, and just listening to the pitch and listening to them storytelling and listening to them talking about their life and their passion and what they are and what they want to do is really my idea of what inspires me and what gives me the kicks when I'm doing podcasting, for that matter. There's so many different kinds of people we're meeting, and so many different stories that they are telling us. So my entire storytelling thing is from a consumer's perspective, from a marketer's perspective, and not from a, from a storyteller's perspective. I'm hardly a storyteller. I'm good at listening. I absorb a lot. And if we have set up this business, it's really about having listened to entrepreneurs like Gautam and decided that, we wanted to, give life to this kind of a business as well.
All right. Okay, so moving on from the generic, like how we like stories and what stories do to us, let's move on to the world of brands and marketing. So, which brand do you think Ramesh has used audio very effectively, consistently, beautifully, anything? I mean, anything like that's called sonic branding. You listen to something and then you can immediately associate the brand with it. What do you think? Which brand has done it?
I think all the brands from my childhood, and really one big learning from this, or one big advantage of this entire lockdown has been that a lot of the old programming came back on television, and some of those guys even started playing their old ads, right? For example, Amul
Amul did it, yeah. Things were
embedded in our memories. And what was embedded in our memory, it was not as much the visual, as much as it was the tune, the sound, the song, the audio. Right? And I think that's the magic of audio. Brands don't give as much value to it today. They do, but it's in passing. It's more for the sake of talking about it rather than the way the importance it had maybe 10 years ago, maybe 15 years ago, when brands were really about the music, about the sound, about the sonic identity, the end, the Britannia ting ting ting. You almost could identify with it. So I think those are the things that make a brand. And I think sound and audio is really a critical element of brand building. And I think that's really what needs to come back. And I would think the brands that have done it well are the brands, that we suddenly see on TV again. I think Airtel did a good job. I remember A.R. Rahman creating a tune. And whenever you picked up a call, the ringtone was that song. And I think that was evocative, and that was really very well done. I don't see too many brands doing as much with it now as brands in the past have done. I think more brands need to do more about it. And it can really help building their brand as well.
All right. Yeah, Sid, what do you think?
Okay, I'm going to go a completely different way. I think if I tell you that, there's a really awkward looking, tallish person, not particularly good looking, who's going to be India's greatest superstar ever, you would have probably said, nah, probably you got it wrong. But I think if you look at Amitabh Bachchan as a brand, right, most of these actors have such phenomenal voices, and the way in which they use those voices are brilliant in building their personality, and therefore can be used by marketing and various brands. So you got Benedict Cumberbatch, you got Amitabh Bachchan, you got so many different people with, even Sunil Shetty, funnily enough, if you just listen to his voice, he's got this nasal voice, right? Which just is so distinctive that you know that it's Sunil Shetty. And then I realized that when we say brand personality, right? We, instead of looking at it only purely from marketing terms, if we just look at it and personify it, okay, and if you look at all these actors, a lot of the good actors have specific distinctive voices. So I would go for Mr. Bachchan.
All right, interesting.
Can't hear you.
Muted yourself.
Pragya, I think you muted yourself.
Yeah. Gautam, go on. What do you think?
Okay. So, I mean, before that, thank you, Ramesh. You give me much more credit than I think I deserve. And that's very, very kind of you. I think to sort of address this question of brands, I think the one benefit of audio, one of the main benefits of audio, is that when we listen to audio, our defenses are lowered. When we're viewing something, we automatically have ad blindness on, or we feel as though there is a particular reason why I'm being shown something, and people have a sort of ulterior motive with it. With audio, it has the ability to pass from our conscious mind to our subconscious mind, which is why when we hear things like Amul, or we'll hear Stephen Fry's voice, or we'll hear Benedict Cumberbatch's voice, or we hear something that is sort of imprinted in our memory, we feel a sense of emotion and a sense of comfort. So if you take the general sense of audio having the ability to pass by our defenses, you're seeing quite a few brands that have really benefited off of this. I'm going to go in a slightly different route. Like, let me give you the example of the brands that punted on advertising on podcasts 4 or 5 years ago in the West. Think about tiny brands like Zip Recruiter, Dollar Shave Club, and a couple of others.
Squarespace.
Yeah,
as well.
Exactly. Yeah. Squarespace. Now, the thing is, these companies, I'm an entire world away, but I know what these companies' value proposition is. I feel like I trust these companies. I feel like these companies are fantastic. And these companies essentially paid pittance at the time that they did to buy host-read advertisements in particular podcasts because they believed in those creators. The very fact that they believed in a creator like Lore, Aaron Mankey in Lore, and they bought host-read advertisements within his podcast, that was essentially their entire top of funnel awareness and branding was taken care of by that tiny little investment, because it reached over 100 million ears just because of that. So that's one sort of avenue where I've seen brands really, really take benefit of audio. A second place that I've seen brands really take benefit of audio are the brands that punted on building podcast networks really early on. If you're looking at WNYC, for example, with Serial, if you're looking at HT Smartcast, if you're looking at Gimlet Media, if you're looking at a few of these very prominent podcasting networks, these guys have essentially built a brand around people trusting in the fact that they create incredible stories. So anything that comes from these brands, there's a cross promotion that exists. There's upselling within the podcast of other podcasts. And it's a fantastic micro ecosystem that they've created within themselves. So brands like that, I think, are really benefiting our podcast. I didn't want to give the stereotypical answers and say McDonald's has made a podcast or Sephora has made a podcast, because these are more recent developments. I'm talking about the organizations that have benefited off of this in a proven way over the last 5 years, that punted on an industry in the West that at that time was just a burgeoning sort of growing industry as we see in India today.
Yeah, makes sense.
Yeah. So what do you think, Gautam? I mean, how is audio really different? Like, why should brands go for audio? Like, if you were to say, let's say, top three things, okay, this is what audio does, apart from the ad blindness and all of that that you've already mentioned, is there anything else that audio does?
Of course. Okay, so let's look at three very simple things that audio does that no medium can do. Number one, audio addresses the passive time of a user's day where they have their device with them but can't engage with them actively by looking at them. 99% of your applications are trying to fight for that period of time, but audio has the ability to carve out some period of time during the 9 hours where people have devices with them but aren't necessarily able to engage with them actively. So in a form like that, your barrier of entry isn't a capital intensive barrier to entry, but rather a medium intensive barrier to entry. That's why audio is so fantastic. Podcasts are also beautiful in the way that they are platform agnostic. They exist across avenues. They don't just exist in one location. So in a scenario like that, again, the sort of passive nature of podcasts is fantastic. The second thing which makes audio so unique is the very fact that it's complementary rather than conflicting. So even when you are, let's say, jogging, or you are on WhatsApp, or you are driving, or you are sleeping, like Sid said, audio accentuates that experience. It doesn't take away from it. So audio is beautiful like that. It's not necessarily immersive. It can be immersive, but it can also not be immersive. And then I think the third and main reason that audio is so beautiful is in its truest form, in its most beautiful form, audio is agnostic to literacy, audio is agnostic to language, and audio is agnostic to capital from the perspective of creators. It is the most democratizing medium there is. It's just that today, the path of creation is exceedingly difficult for a creator. But that's a technological problem. But in its purest form, even if you don't know how to read or write, you can still tell a story. If you don't have a large amount of capital, you can still tell a story. You know, and that's what made me fall in love with it. That it's just beautifully democratizing.
Right. Nice.
Before you can just continue.
Sorry, Ramesh, you were saying something?
I told you can continue listening to him.
Gautam, do you want to go on?
No. I'll put my video off because I'm blushing. But I mean, Ramesh is a legend, so thank you.
Let's listen to him.
All right, Ramesh, how do you think podcast is different with respect to other mediums?
Ramesh is playing his listening role. I think the role of the active listener is very underrated, because I wanted to tell him that when he says, I'm just a marketer, I'm not a storyteller. Actually, marketers are the best storytellers you have, because they're the ones who are creating pull, and they're the ones who are actually weaving stories and meaning around just mere products and services. So Ramesh, you're just selling yourself short, man. So that's one.
All right. Okay, so go on. What do you think? How?
So here's where I get all professorial on you. So, right. So eventually, if you look at podcasting, why are stories good for us? I think stories are good for us because that connects with us as you know, from a prehistoric era. So if you're looking at what creates safety, what creates meaning, what creates inspiration, what creates direction, what creates strategy, those were the campfire stories that were happening between cave people talking to each other, right? So now we are in a situation wherein podcasts are the closest possible to that sort of situation we have. And essentially podcast rather than audio is very good, but if you look at podcasts within audio, podcasts are incredibly flexible, because as Gautam correctly pointed out, not just can you listen to it at various places, but you can have different kinds of podcasts. So you can have a podcast like mine hardly goes for 7 to 8 minutes every single time, or you can have a Joe Rogan podcast which goes on for like 2 hours, 3 hours, etc. Or you can have a podcast which is just about, you know, two people talking and actually having opposing sides and the rest of it. So your imagination is stoked and you have the ability to weave different kinds of stories. So that's one. The second is, I believe that right now podcasts are talking to tastemakers. So if you look at the people who are actually connected and listening to podcasts, they are the early adopters and innovators. So if you look at early adopters and innovators, they are the ones who drive markets. And I'm sure, Pragya, you remember a bit of this.
Yeah, I remember all of it. So we are actually not doing digital marketing, but we are doing marketing in a digitally enabled world.
That's. I think we are talking to influencers and opinion makers through podcasts. That is the biggest.
So these are the early adopters who are going to then trickle it down to the early majority and the late majority and so on. Yeah, nice. All right. Okay, so now I think you can actually tell us what inspired you to do a podcast yourself, Sid. Like, why did you go for podcast as a medium? Apart from, of course, it has flexibility. Of course, all of this is okay, that multitasking. But why did you actually think of creating a podcast yourself? Because you're doing a podcast yourself. You're a podcaster. So why did you do that? What was the inspiration?
I've got a lot of useless information. Okay, which I cannot speak about in lectures because lectures are more streamlined, okay? So that's reason number one. Reason number two is that a lot of students caught me and stoked my ego saying that, hey, we want to listen to more of your stuff. So I got chuffed. So I said, okay. The third thing was I did a podcast. So to be fair, I did a podcast and I did the Filter Coffee podcast with Karthik Nagarajan, wherein he was trying to figure out what I do teaching-wise, etc. And that's when, they said that, hey, you can run a podcast yourself. Just go on one of your bloody rants and it'll be fun. So that's what I do, you know.
Yeah. So you got motivated by everyone around and you just decided to give it a shot.
I'm going to reach my 50th podcast, I think.
Yeah, because you're doing it twice a week. Amazing. Yeah. I mean, such consistency.
I've got a lot of useless information. I think that's how it works.
All right. Okay. Yeah. Okay, Gautam, what inspired you to start Hubhopper? Of course, it was your passion, editing audio, all of that was there. But then, from where did you get the courage to start a startup?
Where I got the courage, I think that's a slightly different story. I think it helped that my job was so boring and that horrible.
Ramu kaka aa gaye.
To make the plunge. I was very lucky. I one day watched a movie called We Bought a Zoo. In that movie, out of context, there's one line that says, sometimes all you need is 20 seconds of courage, just 20 seconds of embarrassing bravery. And I promise you, something great will come out of it. So it was the next day that I went into my boss's office, I put in my papers, and then I started Hubhopper without necessarily knowing what my next step was going to be. But why podcasts and why this medium was essentially because, you know, in my journey of, from the listener's perspective, As I sort of jumped down that Alice in Wonderland rabbit hole, I realized that we as a country have such a strong equation and relationship with the audio medium. I mean, it's intertwined into our lives more than we know. If you walk into a local chemist, they'll be playing the Hanuman Chalisa. If you are having a silent evening, you will hear from pulpits religious sermons. You'll be listening to your grandparents' stories. We've all known Nilesh Mishra or Sarthak or, you know, the great content from Fever or Nasha. We are an audio content-based country. In fact, our behavior with YouTube, and I've mentioned this to Ramesh also in the past, is very strange because as a country, we use YouTube as a listening tool rather than as a viewing tool. So we all put on YouTube, put it on the site, and then continue to listen to it. But none of us ask ourselves why that is. The why is actually because we as a nation pine for an audio content platform, for audio content, and for audio content creation. When I saw that didn't exist, after seeing that the intent for consumption was so high and the intent for creation was so high, it wasn't necessarily a decision anymore. It felt more like a mission. It felt more like a purpose that I had to fulfill. I had to build this space to whatever degree that I could personally. And it's been such a rewarding and incredible journey. And I personally feel that we are about 5% along in the way of where this space is going to go. Though I believe that India, because of the relationship we have with audio, could potentially be the country that other nations look to sort of create create parallels on the basis of, instead of the other way around.
Right. All right. So Ramesh, what do you think? Why did HT Media venture into podcast as a medium? Why did we start HT Smartcast in the first place?
I think primarily because we are a content house. We've been creating content for 100 plus years. Right? And a lot of the content was use and throw content. I mean, it didn't deserve to be use and throw. I mean, what you produce in a newspaper or produce for the radio every day gets thrown the moment it's listened to or the moment it's read. And it was actually injustice to the content that we were producing. We're producing so much content, so much quality content, and all of it was just being used and thrown, and used for 1 minute, 5 minutes, 2 minutes, and so on. So we really wanted to give life to content. We wanted to give justice to our own content creators and make sure that, you know, they get wider reach, you know, wider geographical reach, wider time reach, and you sort of give life to that content, sort of make it something that's living forever, right? That is really the objective. And if you're producing so much content, and why is it that we've been able to go to 100 podcasts in 6 months? It's really because there's so much of content being produced, right? I don't have to struggle for content because content is already there. And I just need to package it and make sure it's shown to the world. It's, you're put in front of the world. And that's really what's happening. So a program, which would otherwise have been lost the moment it was created, now has a life of its own. It'll live longer than all of us. It'll live longer than, everything that's definitely much more than, it would otherwise have been. And that's really the objective. Right? That's really driving us. And we believe that in the course of time, obviously monetization will happen. People will listen to it. And if you've grown from zero to 5 million listens in 5-6 months, and individual programs doing 3 and 4 lakh listens in a month, then I think there is something in it, and we probably missed it earlier, and we probably I don't know, we could be early in the cycle as well, but I think we're there, at the time when we can.
Better late than never.
That's really the motivation.
All right. So very nice talking to you all. Let's take some questions now before we wind it up. So there's a question from Rahul who's asking, need to know a little more on podcast within podcast as stated by Gautam. So Gautam.
Sorry, so just you repeat the question.
Actually, even I didn't get it. Podcast within podcast. I mean, of course, we at HT Smartcast are doing a podcast about podcast. That's called the Great Indian Podman. But I don't know what it means to have a podcast within podcast. He's just mentioned need to know a little more on podcast within podcast as stated by Gautam.
Podcast within podcast.
Gautam, I'm wondering.
I don't know. Okay, anyways, I'll ask him to separately take this up. Okay, how to generate content continuously without running out of ideas? Sid, you can take this, or Gautam, any one of you.
You got to be a little crazy, first of all, right? to do this. The craziness that works for me is that I go for a long walk. I think that's when I get some of the best ideas. I find voice note very useful because I just make a voice note for myself, and so that it kind of stays there. The next thing that really helps is, actually, I wrote a couple of books, and I realized that when I was writing a story, I was too impatient as a writer. And I was that's why, I didn't enjoy the whole process of writing. But I realized that I like the process of creating. I'm a raconteur. So when you look at actually developing any idea, it is the way in which you present that idea. That is what actually makes all the difference. Ideas are there. We've heard of a lot of ideas before. I think it's the way in which you present it, the way in which you discover it, your own genuineness, coming up with it, the authenticity that you can bring to the table. I think that works much more than the idea itself. So it's not about having a new idea every day. It's the way in which you are discovering or stumbling upon that idea.
Yeah. So it's more about your perspective on that idea.
And that's what keeps it genuine. I mean, if you just extend it, sorry for hogging this, if you just extend it, even if the way in which you see podcasters doing advertising, okay, they're doing it in a very straightforward way, in a very genuine way, rather than, you know, now I'm going to advertise and suddenly, so that kind of shit doesn't work. What tends to work is that, okay, this is the product that I'm going, I'm endorsing it and so on and so forth, and then you move ahead. So I think the more authentic you are to how you actually discover an idea, the better it works for you.
Sure. Is there any difference between radio and podcast except the digital on-demand bit? Ramesh, would you like to take this one?
I think it's what Sid was describing as well, what Gautam described earlier. There's a lot of passion when an individual is creating something, right? Radio, to a large extent, has got sort of commercialized, if you don't want to call it that. Podcasting is still a pure medium in that sense. No, it's still, you can still speak from the heart. You know, a radio jockey can't necessarily speak from the heart. There is an advertiser who comes in between. You know, he has to give his own spin to something that he's been told to give. He can't say it exactly as it is. He has to follow the norms. So there are limitations of radio. Of course, most people listen to radio for the music. Here, you're listening to the podcaster for his opinion, for what he has to say, not just for the music, right? That's really the big difference. I think podcasting is a far more, you know, today, a free medium. It's the medium of protest, medium of, you know, of saying what you want without having to feel constrained about it.
Right.
I don't think other publishing mediums are only as good as podcasting. That's really a difference. Maybe podcasting and any medium today.
All right. So we have a lot of questions on what are the basic requirements to begin a podcast, then tips for those who want to start a podcast, and then how do we make financial news? Sorry?
I think Gautam is the right person to answer.
Yeah. So all of these are like similar questions. What if one wants to become a podcast creator? What factors should one keep in mind? How to engage listeners? How do we create an audience? What are the basic requirements to start a podcast? What should we absolutely not do? All of this. Yeah, so all these are similar questions, and Gautam, you can take this one. And
I think the first thing is don't think too much and don't speculate too much before starting. I think a lot of people have the fear of when they start, the entire world is waiting to hear that one episode. You shouldn't feel that way. You should essentially start with the assumption that it's just you and maybe a couple of other people that listen. It'll give you a lot more comfort to start. If you're looking at the technicalities of starting, it used to be fairly, fairly difficult because you would have a hosting platform that sat in Avenue A. Then you'd have a recording studio that sat in Avenue B. Then you'd have a, you had your post-production that sat in Avenue C. It could be done on your own with software, or you could essentially get a freelancer to do it. Then you had to go and get your syndicated feed and deposit it into each of these different avenues, and then try to figure out how to get analytics and sort of build tools. But now you're actually seeing, and I'm actually going to try very hard not to pitch Hubhopper here, because my immediate like go-to reaction is pitching Hubhopper. But I think what you need to essentially do is you need to go to a platform that essentially takes care of all of this, the process from your hosting all the way to your distribution and analytics. So a platform where you can host, where you can begin recording there itself, you can sort of do your editing on the platform itself. Don't get sort of caught up with having the perfect podcast in terms of post-production. In fact, the data that we see says that overproduced podcast actually doesn't do as well because it doesn't feel as real. It doesn't feel as genuine. At the end of the day, the listener is looking for companionship and the listener is looking for somebody that they can trust. The more produced the podcast is, the further away it feels in terms of being approachable and being amiable and amicable and essentially friendly. With all of this, of course, we have a platform called Hubhopper Studio, but there are other platforms that do this as well, where you can start and it's free through the entire process. But at the end of the day, the one thing that you need to focus on is if you take the plunge and create your first episode, even if your first episode is just a 2-minute description about yourself, or a few minute, a 2-minute description about what you want your podcast to be on, you would have, I think you would have sort of jumped over the major hurdle of starting your podcasting journey.
Yeah. So basically, like when you don't know where to start, you just kind of start.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah. Just count to 20. By the time you've reached 20, click start podcast or submit podcast and let it go out into the world, and then start your journey from there. And also look at it from the perspective that, I mean, if you're not only looking at it from the perspective of yourself as an individual, every time one person creates a podcast, this small community grows larger. I remember the days not too long ago where the podcasting community was a hole in the wall, where like it would be 10 people that you could count on your hands. Now this community has grown to a few thousands. And every time one person becomes a podcaster, it grows by one. And there is huge power in numbers. And this movement needs that community. So if you're not doing it for yourself, do it for the community and just start. That's my opinion. And yeah, I'm just going to throw Hubhopper Studio out there again. Not promoting it, but you can start.
In a sense, promoting it. Yeah, subtly promoting it. All right, so there are a couple of questions on the format of podcast and what audiences. I think I can take it up. Doesn't really matter which format, content is more important. And what are the relevant audiences? It's generally 18 to 34, Gen Zs, millennials. And people
can
consume...
I can give you a couple of things here.
I think this is going to end itself. I don't know. I'm not sure if it will end itself or I'll have to end it. It's 40 minutes actually over. Yeah, it's going to...
extended.
It'll be extended. Like we can go on. Like.
I saw a little sign saying it has been extended or something like that.
All right. So we can go on. If it ends, then it ends. That's okay with us.
Yeah, there you go.
All right, Gautam. Yeah, please go on then.
Tips and tricks, keep it between 10 minutes if you want. Please include your audience. Make sure you use words like we. Make sure you use inclusive words. Tend to work really well. Bilingual podcasts do really well in India. If you're in the horror genre, you're doing fantastically well. If you're in emotive storytelling, you're doing fantastically well. Please tell your listener to come back for your next episode. Pester them a lot. The more you pester them, right now there's the listener is very accommodating, so the listener will not be bothered. If you tell them to come back 2 or 3 times, they will come back. The important thing to do is to build that small base and to speak just to them. Understand your listener. That's it.
All right. Okay. How does one promote a podcast? Ramesh, do you want to take this up?
Yeah. So that's a big mystery, how to promote a podcast. And even trying our best to promote podcasts and making sure, but we've had some successes. I mean, one thing that has worked for us is really making sure that our podcasts are available across platforms. So, you know, and working with platforms as partners. So whether it's JioSaavn, whether it's Gaana, Spotify, Hubhopper, any of these, we work with most of them as partners, and therefore we're able to work with them to promote our podcast as well. And what we find is that, you know, if the content is, number one, content has to be good. Number two, if these platforms find it, actually getting them traffic and getting them listens, they are keen to promote your podcast. I think we've got reasonable traction with religious programming over the last 1 or 2 months. We've got some good traction with health programming. We've got traction with a little bit of political kind of stuff that we do of our Hindustan Times kind of portfolio. We got good traction on the economic stuff as well, which is done under the banner of Mint Podcast. So content matters. I think we do serious content, and therefore serious listeners come and listen to it. The things that we do from a religious perspective are things that we've done on radio before, things like Jai Bajrangi, and surprisingly, the number one podcast in the country, I think this month, would be Jai Bajrangi. It had 450,000 listens last month. So obviously people are praying very hard, and to Hanuman especially. And hopefully we'll get relieved of our COVID pandemic problems as a result of the fact that so many people are listening to Jai Bajrangi on HT Smartcast and other platforms. So in terms of promoting it, I think some of it works without promoting, some of it works in partnerships, and I think like Gautam said, make sure you tell them to come back and listen to it again every time you finish a podcast.
Yeah, and also I think social media is one very good way to promote podcasts, cross promotion, social media.
Very social media, and that's really been the large majority of our discovery has happened.
All right. Okay, how could we make financial news an interesting and relevant podcast to listen to? Who wants to take it up? Gautam, do you want to take it up?
I think we started doing it, and surprise, the one we do with an artificial intelligent voice, and that's the one that we're testing out right now. It's an AI voice, and it does better listens than the normal human voice. So that's an interesting thing that we've discovered in the last few months. We're doing a news podcast with AI, and that seems to be getting 2,000, 3,000 listens every time it goes on air at 8 o'clock in the morning and 6 o'clock in the evening. That's true of financial news as well.
All right. And
Gautam had something to add.
Gautam, please go on.
No. I didn't have... all I was going to say is that, there are, in terms of your financial podcast, especially venture capitalists, you have some great VC-based podcasts that already exist. So Matrix, for example, Matrix Partners has a great podcast. If you're looking at Bertelsmann has a great podcast. One of my favorite podcasts from a few years ago was a podcast between Y Combinator and Stanford called How to Start a Startup. Then there was another one by a VC called Underscore Ventures called Startup Secrets. So a lot of people actually use podcasts to consume financial-based information. I think what's important is to make sure that the information is not monotonous. If you can have guests that are experts in their field, it adds a lot of weight and it adds some meat to the podcast. That's it.
Yeah, makes sense.
So there's a question on what does the road ahead look like for podcast industry amid current scenarios. Ramesh, can you take this up?
I think the two of them will be better people.
I was just in the chat window. I'd like to take another question. Aniket has asked a question about people consume video content because it becomes easy to focus with visuals in place. When it comes to podcast, focus is the biggest challenge, I feel. I'd like to answer that. So what I feel is that if you look at the biggest strength of the podcast is the lack of focus, the way in which I see it. So I don't think that we should be looking at it to kind of replace video content. It is actually the fact that visuals are missing. That means that you can do something else. You can chill out a little and a different part of your brain is actually listening to the podcast, Aniket. So if you just think about it that way, yes, you're right. That's why visuals work a lot. That's why Instagram works a lot. That's why YouTube works a lot, TikTok, etc. And they have a place. But if you look at podcasts, the place is different. So in fact, the post-COVID, right? If you see when people start driving out and the rest of it, you'll see a sudden surge of podcast listeners come back to the fold, because you will get people who drive and listen, sleep, go to sleep and listen. I think that is the key differentiator. The lack of focus actually works for a podcast.
All right. Yeah, what's the best genre when it comes to storytelling apart from crime, romance, and horror? Ramesh, do you want to take this up? The best genre when it comes to storytelling apart from crime, romance, and horror?
I wouldn't know. I'm a marketeer and I will market any content from any genre. whatever works with consumers is what my formula is, but I'm sure Siddharth and Gautam can add to that.
I think your interview-based podcasts are really great in the way that if you are getting prominent people from across a particular industry that are adding value to people, it's super important to constantly let your listener know that this is the person that's going to be on the podcast in the next week, and then this is what's going to come the next week. People come because the sort of perspective is fresh. I think, like Sid was mentioning a little while ago, your guards are a little bit down even when you're creating a podcast. So you may be able to learn certain things, or maybe able to sort of get a perspective from these people that you wouldn't otherwise get. Like a great example for me, not that I'm a huge fan of the Joe Rogan Experience or the Bill Burr's Monday Morning Podcast, but if you look at both of these podcasts and you see like Elon Musk on the podcast, you will see Elon Musk or hear Elon Musk in a way that you would never otherwise see him, or you would never otherwise sort of watch him on video because his guards are up. If you even read an article that Elon Musk has published, it's much more sanitized. It's much more sort of like covered in coatings of like polish. But when you listen to him on the podcast, I mean, he got into big trouble. Like on the podcast, he started smoking and his stock price fell. So you can tell at the end of the day how comfortable people get during a podcast. So that's why I think interview-based podcasts are fantastic to do. And I think there's a big scope for them in India.
Yeah.
All right. Let's move on to this question that was actually got missed. So what does the road ahead look like for podcast industry? Sid, do you want to take it up?
Yeah, look, first of all, I think everybody and their mother and grandmother is going to try and do a podcast, right? Which is good. Which is good news. But the fact is that because there's going to be such a slew of content, there'll be a need for differentiators and there'll be a need for actually appreciating the wheat from the chaff. So that is going to actually happen over the next 2 to 2.5 years. I see that a large glut of content, a lot of it being mediocre, but enthusiastic, some of the gems coming out and connecting. The second thing that I do see about podcasts is different styles of podcasts coming in and actually connecting, and we will stop using the word podcast. What will happen is that, I listen to the Joe Rogan Experience or I'll stuff like that. And over a period of time, you're going to actually connect it to the kind of value that you're going to get from that thing. I think that the word podcast actually does podcast a disservice, because it's not very evocative. It doesn't actually tell you what you can actually experience. So I think over the next couple of years, you're going to actually connect to, it's like, we don't talk of electricity, but we talk of switching the light on. So it's moved from electricity to light, right? So it's going to actually happen that way. We're going to then talk about individual podcasts. And the third thing I see is that people are going to connect their social media presence in a much stronger way with their podcast.
I couldn't agree more, actually, on especially I think I've spoken to Ramesh about this, especially the word podcast. Not only is it not evocative, it's also very alienating, because it comes from your iPod and broadcast ka culmination. And that immediately makes, 99% of the country feel like this is meant for people that consume Apple products. It's very alien to me. I don't feel like I can connect with it. So then they tend to steer a little clear from it. I think the next year, couple of years, you're even going to see a lot of consolidation taking place. Players in this space, you're going to see them coming together, partnering. You're going to see a lot of that also happening. You're going to see, like Sid mentioned, the democratization of creation, which I think is fantastic. Because one of the main things that that's going to do is it's going to localize what podcast means in India. I think today we still look at the West as a bar for us to gauge and judge our podcasts by. But podcasts here mean a very different thing. Like, for example, podcasts here have the ability to disrupt the education system. Podcasts here have the ability to disrupt how information is disseminated in primary industries like agriculture. Imagine farmers across the country being able to listen to a podcast on the best ways to harvest crops or the best ways to, for example, irrigate their crops. The second it takes on a localized avatar, the second we stop looking at it as something that we borrowed from the West and we're building here, that is when you're going to see the real beauty of this space come to life. I still feel that we are hiding under the shadow of the fact that this medium has come to us from the West. That's complete shit. It hasn't come to us from the West. This medium has existed here. We have to find the localized places where it impacts and affects our country and the localized creators and listeners that want to partake in this industry. And that's when we'll actually see this space becoming what it needs to be.
Yeah, right. Yep. I think Ramesh and I will also agree to this because most of our listeners as well are coming from cities like Patna and Lucknow and all of these tier 2 cities. So, yeah, we'll just take one last question and then we close this. The question is, how do we distinguish between good podcast and bad podcast? Any comments, Gautam?
If you're a podcaster, I would say data, data, data. Nothing is more important. Keep looking at what is working. Don't be afraid to experiment. Because the thing is, to say good versus bad, that's far too subjective. At the end of the day, what is good for me may not be good for somebody else. Like, for example, we ran an original podcast on Hubhopper called Paranormal Reality. It was a paranormal investigator who was going from haunted location to haunted location, and in the Blair Witch Project format, he was recording podcasts in those bhoot bungalows. Now, the thing is, the production quality was atrocious. If somebody was going to look at it from a sound engineer's perspective, they'd say that this is the worst podcast on the planet. But the roaring attention and love that existed for that podcast was incomparable. We had millions of listeners on that podcast just because of the fact that that podcaster tuned into something that was very inherent in what people wanted to listen to. He would end his podcast episode on a cliffhanger. So he would end it with the sound cutting. You didn't know if he lived through that episode or didn't. And then he would stop existing on social media. This guy named Jay Alani. And I the way that he made his podcast so immersive and community driven was fantastic. So for a lot of people, that would be a terrible podcast because if they're aficionados of sound engineering and audio design, it's a terrible podcast. But if you're looking at it as being captivating content, it's a fantastic podcast. What you need to do as a podcaster is keep looking at your data. Where is it working? Build your personas of your audience. Understand who your MVS is, your minimum viable segment, and just keep catering to them. That's it.
Absolutely. Thank you. Thank you, Gautam. Thank you, Sid. Thank you, Ramesh. I think this was a very enriching session and I got to learn a lot of things, and I think our listeners and viewers also learned so many new things. Thanks, everyone. And for individuals who want to do podcasts, we are there, hdsmartcast.com. You can have a look. We have a partner with us, Page. My number is there. My name is written there. So you can contact me or you can ping me on LinkedIn for brands, for marketers who are watching this. You want to invest into podcasts, you want to venture into podcasts, please go and visit our Partner With Us page and you might as well listen to some of our podcasts. So thank you everyone for joining in. It was a great session, someone is saying. So yeah, thanks everyone. Thank you. Bye-bye. Thanks, Sid. Thanks, Ramesh. Yeah. Thanks, Gautam. Bye-bye. Thank you.
Thank you so much, guys. It's such a pleasure. Thank you.
Yeah.
Same here, Gautam and Ramesh and Pragya. Thank you so much.
Yeah.
Bye.
Thank you.
Bye. Bye.